It's no secret that film cameras have been jumping up in price over the last couple of years. A rise in popularity combined with high demand and limited supply for certain models means that if you want one of the iconic cameras out there, it's going to cost you. But sometimes lost in all of that is the fact that there are still all sorts of old, unique, quirky, and capable options available that won't drain your bank account. So what I thought it'd be fun to do is just give myself a budget of around, say, £50 or $75 US to jump on eBay and find a medium format camera that was both tested and working. And I really wanted to do this just as a way to help kind of remind people and also get them excited that you can still pick up a camera that can shoot a massive sized negative for pretty much next to nothing. And the camera that I ended up buying was the Lomo Lubitel 166B. The Lubitel 166 has been around forever, first released in 1949 by Lomo, also known as the Leningrad Optical Mechanical Association. This 166B version came to market in 1980 and was produced until 1989. This camera was so popular that the current company, Lomography, still sells it today in the form of the 166 Plus, although their new version will cost you over $300 US, which would definitely change how attractive this camera is for me. Okay, so out today, turn around. Making some images with this camera, and the one thing that I kind of keep telling myself that I gotta remember is that I don't start comparing this camera in my head to kind of more expensive cameras that I used, and I just have to accept the fact that there's bound to be some kind of quirks with this thing that come with it just because of the price. So, trying to keep that in mind. Oh, and look at this. That is off of the lens. Let's see if we can get a shot of that. That fell off while I was filming. So funny, that's actually right where I stopped doing this walk and talk. So talk about good luck there. Would have been without a focusing ring for the day. The joys of cheaper cameras. Okay, so first impressions after using this camera for a little bit now. It's definitely really kind of lightweight and compact, and it actually doesn't feel that cheap considering the price. But probably the one thing that's standing out the most, I'm going to talk about this later, but it's just composing with this. So it's the finder in this. And basically, if you don't have your head positioned at the perfect kind of angle, you see the barrel of the taking lens in the finder. So it's really kind of frustrating and finicky. And that is probably the biggest thing that's bothering me so far with this. So this camera actually doesn't have a ground glass for the entire finder. It just has this center spot right in the middle of the viewfinder, and that's what you use to focus with. So I found that you almost always have to use this flip down magnifier to be able to check your focus. You can't just kind of eyeball it like you can on a normal TLR. So again, for the price, it's not a huge deal, but that combined just with having that perfect angle so you don't see the barrel of the lens makes just composing and focusing with this camera a little bit of a chore. So a couple of other things that stood out to me. The first one is just the lack of shutter speed options. So the fastest shutter speed is 1/250th of a second, and then it goes down to 1/15th of a second. So there's 5 speeds in total, as well as bulb. And not that that's really a huge deal, but I guess I'm just used to working with cameras that have quite a few more options. So that just stood out to me. And then the second thing is the way that this camera focuses. So on most TLRs, you usually have a focusing knob on the side of the camera, but this camera instead has these geared rings on the taking lens and the viewing lens. So when you turn either one, the gears engage and the lenses move at the same time. And I don't know if there's necessarily anything bad with that, although like you've seen, I had some issues with the front of the lens being loose and then falling off. So I'd worry a little bit about if that could affect anything moving forward. Okay, so just finished up Portra 400 and gonna load some HP5, I think. Never really shoot too much black and white. So it's funny, I'm trying not to shoot anything faster than f8 because part of me just doesn't trust the focusing system on this camera, especially considering the fact that the front of the lens fell off at one point. But then since it's so gray today, that's forcing me to shoot at 1/60th of a second. So I'm also a little nervous about camera shake. Just gotta cross my fingers at this point. Okay, so kind of hating this thing. You know, I'm trying to keep in mind the price. It just has these quirks. I've probably shot like 4 double exposures accidentally now because I keep forgetting to wind the film. That's my own fault. But yeah, when you're used to working with something more refined, it's just taking some getting used to. So when it comes to image quality, I gotta say, I was actually pretty impressed with this camera, and that's for the images that actually turned out. I shot 3 rolls of film through this camera. The first one was Ektar, second was Portra 400, and then the third roll was some HP5. The first roll of Ektar worked pretty good, and the images were actually surprisingly sharp when scanned on the CoolScan 9000. Although I gotta say, the lens definitely does suffer from some vignetting, which really wasn't a huge surprise. The next roll of Portra is when things started to really go downhill, and the first couple of images I created worked out well, but after having that issue with the front of the lens, every image I created for the rest of the day just seemed to be a little bit soft, as if the focus was missed. The roll of HP5 is where things pretty much just fell apart, and I'm not sure if that's because the shutter speeds were acting up and they were inaccurate, but most of the images came out really soft, as if there was a bunch of camera shake, even though I never shot slower than 1/60th of a second. So when I think about my time spent with this camera, I keep coming back to 2 things, and that's just the image quality and the price. And you know, when you compare this to a higher end system, I think the biggest standout differences really are going to be the usability and reliability. And yes, you know, systems like the Pentax 672 or a Mamiya 7 are definitely gonna have better optics, but I still think when you're exposing a larger size negative, like a 6x6, even if you don't have the best lens in front of it, you're still working with a massive size piece of film when you compare it to something like a 35mm negative. And for that reason, you're still able to get some really impressive results, even with a cheap camera like this 166B. So it's almost like it was meant to be. Just finished the review. Set the camera right here for a minute while I was packing up. And now it is there. Single use. I hope it's still okay. There was no film in it anymore. But yeah, thing's cursed. There's the focus ring. Definitely broken, the back lid crack. So good thing I finished the review. 3 rolls of film, but the old camera is, it's done. So even though this camera was a little finicky to work with, and I probably wouldn't use it moving forward, I definitely won't because it's broken now. I just don't think that when you take the price into account, there's any way you could say that this thing's a bad deal, especially with the size of the negative and the resulting image quality. But those things aside, I think that the Lomo Lubitel 166B is just a really great reminder that even in today's current film photography world, where things seemingly won't stop getting more expensive, there's still plenty of very affordable options out there, especially if you have a little bit of patience and don't mind a couple of quirks. I got a place in my heart. I still love you, baby. Believe me, honey. That's a place.